Welcome to the Science Asylum. I am Nick Lucid. First, I want to say that I know we've been doing a lot of Einstein's relativity lately. It's challenging stuff. I also know that some of you were a little confused about space-time diagrams, and I kind of glazed over the details in the comment responses. We're going to address some of those details in this video. And then starting next month, we're going to get back to some normal topics. I must bring balance to the Force. to the channel. Okay, let's start with some basics. First, space-time is a giant collection of points called events. Those events can be anything. The moment a car begins to move, the moment it stops, that time you woke up in bed this morning, your birth, the Big Bang, or you clicking this video. A space-time interval is what you get when you connect two events. All the events between the front and the back of the car, we call its length. All the events between when this car starts and when it stops, we call its space-time path. How slanted that path is depends on speed. Anything with mass, me, the car, a water molecule, the Earth, or a proton, anything you might call an object, must travel more through time than it does through space. The time component is always bigger for the space-time path of an object. Things without mass, like photons of light, travel along diagonal paths, where the time and space components are the same size. Wait, the same size? Yeah, that's where things get weird. We use something called a line element to measure the size of a space-time path. And in flat space-time, it looks something like this. You can see it's not traditionally flat because of the stupid negative. Time behaves opposite to space. For objects like you or me, this isn't such a big deal. We move more through time, so our paths have size. Light, on the other hand, light always moves the same through time and space, which means its time and space perfectly cancel each other. And since we base all other measurements on space and time, all measurements in a massless particle's frame are zero. Photons experience all time in a single moment and all space in a single place. No, we see it move around at the speed of light, so it must experience both. You're not thinking four-dimensionally. Remember, all motion is relative, and so is time and space. It's the universe in which we live, so you better keep up the pace. We see light move with great ferocity, even when it gleams. But the closer you get to its velocity, the smaller space and time seem. Okay, that's enough of that. Thanks for liking, sharing, and subscribing. And until next time, remember, it's okay to be a little crazy. Oh, I almost forgot. More comments. Kyzer Cube mentioned that the speed of light might have been given the symbol C for the Latin word celeritas, meaning swiftness. There's actually some historical debate about this. It is true that the letter C for celeritas was used extensively in wave equations during the 1800s to represent the speed of a wave. However, the C used for the speed of light did not come from a wave equation. It came from a disproven alternative to Maxwell's electromagnetism, where it represented a constant. History is kind of a blundered mess. I also mentioned that the curvature equations in relativity were only defined locally. And whoever I am was wondering how locally exactly. Technically speaking, infinitesimally local. They really only apply over infinitely small intervals in space-time, which is true of most fundamental physics equations. If the changes from one event to the next are really small, though, you can get away with applying the word local to whole objects or collections of objects. But at that point, you're just approximating. Okay, that's it for real. Next time, there's a normal topic.